going to do right now. I'll toss it over to Chef Dan so we can start his demonstration today. Now, today he's going to be cooking up some ratatouille with the Parmesan polenta. So, Chef Dan, I'm going to go ahead and toss it over to you. So, Chef Dan, take it away.
Awesome. Hey, all. Thank you so much for making time and joining on this Saturday morning, wherever you are. I know it's different time zones. For those of you that woke up earlier, for those of you that made time in the middle of your day, thank you. I greatly appreciate it. So today we're going to do a quick demo, right? We're going to do ratatouille and a grilled Parmesan polenta and create a plate here. So this is a vegetarian dish, not vegan, due to the cheese that we're adding in here. But you could omit the cheese and make it a vegan style dish here. That being said, ratatouille takes about half an hour in the oven once you get everything kind of sauteed and good to go. So we're going to use some movie magic here, some camera magic, if you will, and do a little bit of a speed up process. But we will open it up for questions at the end. So you can ask any questions that I didn't cover or if I was unclear about anything. So awesome. Thank you for joining me in my home. This is my kitchen. I know it's a little bit of a galley kitchen, but I think that just brings home the point a little bit. Anyone can cook. If you've seen the movie Ratatouille, again, like the dish we're making, anyone can cook. You don't need a lot. You just need to take the time to do it. So I'm going to show you how to take the time and create a ratatouille dish. So we'll move on over to the cutting board here. Awesome. All right, so for ratatouille, there's a few ingredients that we need. So we need our fresh flat leaf parsley here. I have my thyme and bay leaves, thyme already chopped up, bay leaves ready to go. And then I have my crushed tomatoes. These are just canned crushed tomatoes. You can also buy whole tomatoes and crush them with your hand here. And then lastly, we need onion, zucchini, and bell peppers. Okay, and a little bit of garlic. So here I have the zucchini, onion, green and red bell peppers already chopped up and sauteed. And then together we're gonna saute the eggplant here, the last half of the eggplant that I have, and mix it all together and get it going in the oven. So why would you cook these separately? Why would you not just saute them all together here? Because they have different densities. Eggplant, if you were to take a little cube of it and cut it up and squeeze it between your fingers, very porous, very spongy, right? So that's going to cook really, really fast. Same with zucchini. Onions and peppers have the same density, so they can be cooked and sauteed together. So I sauteed my onions and peppers together and then added a little bit of garlic to get that cooked. But I did saute the zucchini separately, again, because it's very porous and spongy here. So it takes sauteing in multiple parts, and then you're going to add it into the dish all at the end here. So at this point, since we have everything sauteed and good to go, I'm going to go ahead and cut the eggplant. The way that I like to cut this, I'm aiming for 1/4-inch cubes. Okay. So I'm going to start by creating a nice flat area. That's a big surface. It's about 1/4-inch wide, and want them all the same here. Okay. So here I have my three parts of eggplant that I'm going to cut up. Once I have my big flat surface area all close to the same height here, I'm going to come and create 1/4-inch strips. Okay, notice I'm using the claw grip here, which means I'm tucking my fingertips back so that I don't cut the tips of my finger off. And then I can also put the knife against this knuckle here. So if I do cut anything, it's going to be the tip of the knuckle and I'm not going to shorten my finger. So I've cut it into the 1/4-inch strips, and then I'm going to come back and do 1/4-inch, 1/4-inch, 1/4-inch here for the eggplant. Okay, so you can see they're all relatively the same size. They don't need to be perfect. This is a very rustic dish, but we do want them to be close to the same size. Same thing as we talked about before, we want them to cook evenly. Okay, if any pieces are bigger, they're not going to cook at the same speed as everything else. The little ones are going to burn while the big ones are undercooked. So again, just getting them all really close to the same size here. Okay, have some strips, awesome, beautiful. Important tip when sauteing here, I wanna make sure my pan is hot before I add anything to it. Okay, so I've already turned my pan on. I've added a little bit of oil here. So that's good to go to start the sauteing. And now I'm going to take this from the cutting board and get it into the pan. How am I going to do that, right? I could pick it up a few times or I can scrape it in. Recommendation here. This part of the knife isn't sharp. Good, this part is. Sharp things dull, right? Everyone has a dull knife at home that they haven't sharpened in a while and it doesn't work as well. And the quickest way to injure yourself is with a dull knife. So to keep this side sharp down here, I'm going to flip the knife over, take my cutting board, and then move my eggplant into the oil here. Okay, this way I'm keeping my knife sharp and I can get everything in. Awesome. All right. So eggplant, being super coarse here, is going to need a little bit of extra oil. Okay, it absorbs the oil so fast that we're going to add more oil to this than we would any of the other items. Onions and peppers have that hard outer shell. They only need a little bit of oil. Eggplant and zucchini need a little bit more because, again, they're so porous, they're going to absorb it up. As you can see, when you're looking at it, those darker ones have already just absorbed the oil, right? And I want to make sure everything touches the oil here. So I'm going to start sauteing this. What I'm looking for here, I'm not looking for color. We are just part cooking everything because it's going to go in the oven for 30 minutes, okay? So I wanna make sure that everything is just part cooked. What that means is it's not fully cooked, it's still a little bit raw, but I've started to break down the outside of it, okay? All right, so everybody with me so far? We've already cooked our onions and peppers and garlic separately. We cooked our zucchini separately, and now we're doing the last of the dish. So ratatouille, we're gonna have the eggplant, onions, peppers, zucchini, and garlic in there. Okay, so I'm sauteing the last little bit here, this eggplant. All right. So here at this point, when you look at it, you can see that the majority of it is starting to get darker, it's starting to break down, it's getting a little bit soft. So this eggplant is good to go. It only took about a minute of sauteing to get it part cooked. Again, super porous, like a sponge here. So that's what I want. So at this point, right, this is where I can add everything else back in. So I'm going to take my onions, pepper, zucchini that I've already cut up and sauteed, just part cooked them, and add it back into this dish. Okay. Beautiful. At this point, I'm not trying to cook anything. So I'm going to turn my heat down. All of my vegetables have been hard cooked here. So I'm just trying to get a nice even spread of everything throughout. So you can see everything's spread out pretty evenly. We have nice bits of color here. And the last part we're going to do to get this ratatouille finished, right? We've sauteed everything, we've mixed it all together. The last part we're going to do is add the rest of the ingredients here. So the rest of our ingredients are going to be a little bit of flat leaf parsley, okay, for that nice, earthy, slightly citrus flavor profile. We're gonna save the rest for garnish on top of our dish. Then we have bay leaves here. I have dried bay leaves, and then I have some chopped up fresh thyme, okay? And that's this at the bottom, very citrusy, very earthy here. So I'm going to add those two in. Okay. I'm gonna mix those herbs all around here. One thing I do want to do is I want to keep the bay leaves whole. Bay leaves, essentially, if you were to eat them whole or eat it just plain here, it will make you sick. It is slightly poisonous to the human body. So I want to know where they are at all times because I will remove them at the end of cooking. Beautiful. Saute vegetables, thyme, parsley. We have our bay leaves. And then I have a little bit of mixture of salt and pepper right here. I'm going to sprinkle it with. Add some flavor. The reason I didn't season it during the saute process is because I wanted to add it all at the end. I didn't want to salt four different things and then have an overly salty dish. So just adding a little bit near the end is going to bring that flavor here. All right, and ratatouille, the last and most important ingredient in the vegetable is going to be our crushed tomato here. Okay, so I'm going to pour this all around. Beautiful. And then spread it throughout evenly. This tomato is going to create a sauce for us. That's why this is so important to have that tomato in there. It's going to thicken up and kind of bind everything together, as you'll see in the finished product here. So I just want to spread it around and make sure it's nice and evenly spread throughout. So it looks like a vegetable marinara, except a little bit less tomato sauce than you would have for marinara. Okay. Awesome. Okay, finished product. So you can see the tomato in there, you can see all the colors, everything cut up and par cooked. This is ready to go in the oven to get to our finished product, okay? So last thing I do before I put it in the oven, I'm going to cover it with a lid, okay? Very important to cover it with a lid. You can cover it with plastic wrap and foil, but it does need a tight seal so that it cooks on itself. If you put it in uncovered, all that liquid is going to leave and it's going to be very dry and crusty, okay? So I have this tight seal on it and I'm gonna put it in the oven for half an hour. Beautiful. Okay, so our ratatouille is in the oven and going. I've got my timer set. I'm good to go. I'm going to wait for that to get all finished up. Next step that we're going to do so that everything comes up together is I'm going to grill the polenta. Excuse me. Awesome. Okay, let's talk about polenta. Polenta is, I'm trying to think of some similar examples here, are going to be like instant mashed potatoes or grits. Okay, so if you ever make grits, you boil a little bit of water, reduce it down to a simmer, add some salt in there, and then you pour your polenta in. Okay, and then you cook it. There are two options here. At this point, you can serve it as is, where it's soft, it's mushy, it's almost like mashed potatoes, instant mashed potatoes, it's creamy, and you can put that into the center of your plate and put the ratatouille over the top. Other option is to cook it the night before, which is what I did. So I cooked it, I poured it into this because this was the size that I needed, and I let it sit in the fridge. So my end product is now solid. Okay, so now I have the solid mass of polenta, which means that I can make it a little bit more attractive here. The way that I'm gonna make it attractive is I'm going to grill it. And by grilling it, I'm gonna create those beautiful marks and have some shapes that I can play with. So what I wanna work with today are triangles. So first thing I'm going to do is take this solid mass, get rid of these ends. These are gonna be little snacks for me later. To get into triangles here, I'm going to start by breaking it into squares, okay? And then to get these squares into triangles, you see these squares here, I would come in and cut it diagonally. Oh, sorry, make sure we're on the camera. I would come in and cut it diagonally, so I have these firm triangles right here. But before I do that, I want to get the grill marks on it. It's much easier to work with this than it is with the triangles. If you're working with the triangles, those tips are likely to fall off and break. So here I have my grill pan. It's basically like an outdoor grill, but on the in that I can use indoors here. So it has those raised ridges that I can get the grill marks on. So I'm going to take this and set it down in here. It's already oiled, it's already hot and good to go. I'm going to set these squares on here to get this beautiful, to get those beautiful grill marks so that I can have those pretty grill marks for the grilled polenta on the plate. Save those splitter. Any questions in the chat that popped up at this point? Cool. I promise I'll come to questions at the end too. So this part, again, high heat, grilling indoors. Anytime you're using this indoors, the point that it should be at is close to smoking. Okay, you don't want it smoking. Smoking means burning, smoking means a fire is about to happen. But I want it as close to smoking as possible, which is why it's a little bit hard to grill indoors. And this is how I'm gonna get that quadrillage, those grill marks on the side of it here. Okay, so moving it around, making sure I'm getting those grill marks.
Chef Bears, we have a couple of questions coming in.
Awesome.
So how long does it take to cook the polenta?
Great question. It takes about 5 minutes. Very simple. This is the polenta that I use. Okay. So when you open it up and when you go to look at it, see if I can get this. It's almost like a dusting right here. It's very, very thin and very small grains. And this absorbs the water pretty fast. So you pour, I follow the recipe on the back. I think it's 3 cups of water to 1 cup of polenta here while it was simmering. And then once it starts to thicken up, and you'll taste it along the way and make sure that it's nice and tender. Great question.
And then also, what are the heat levels that you're currently using for the polenta and also for the ratatouille?
Great question. Polenta is sitting at high or close to high, just below high on my stove. This will change based on your stove. If you have a gas burner, if you have a flat top electric, that will make a big difference for you here. But when grilling indoors, you absolutely want to make sure it's high to get that quadrillage. If you go low, it's not going to get those grill marks that you're looking for. Okay. Cool. And then for the oven, for the ratatouille, I have it set to 325 is what I'm using for half an hour here. And there was a recipe provided with this, so you can see these recipes and follow it along the way. Great question.
All right. And then also another question came in. Is polenta available at the store? I think you already answered that one. Is polenta the same as cornmeal? Can I use cornmeal is what Paula is asking.
Great question. It is not the same as cornmeal, but it comes from a different type of corn here. So the big difference is going to be the coarseness. So cornmeal is pretty finely ground. You can find coarse, you can find fine. Polenta is a different coarseness. It's about that medium coarseness here. And it is a different type of corn. So very, very similar, right? But cornmeal would not be the best substitute. It would not firm up like polenta would for the grilling here. Great questions. All right, so I've just flipped these. So this this outer part that you can see standing up doesn't have that quadrillage. Basically what happened is I put it in the fridge and the top created this film. So it's gonna take a lot longer to get that pretty grill mark on top of it. So I switched it over to the softer side that was in the pan, and hopefully that will get us some quadrillage here. And quadrillage is a fancy word that means those diamonds that you see on grilled steak.
All right, another question just came in. Why are you using polenta for ratatouille?
Great question. It is a beautiful flavor profile here. It's pretty neutral. It's very slightly sweet and slightly nutty. Okay, so ratatouille can be served over rice, it can be served over bread, it can be served by itself as a vegetable dish, but I'm making it a full meal here. So to get that full meal, I want to create a starch that it's going to sit on to help fill you up. Polenta pairs super well with Parmesan, which has that nutty cheesiness that we want to add at the end, which also pairs well with the acidity and earthiness of the vegetables. Great question.
All right, very good. Guys, feel free to ask questions about what Chef Dan is cooking up here. If you're curious about the process or temperatures, all that good stuff, I mean, feel free to ask away.
Definitely. So like I said, on this polenta here, basically the top part sat open air. I didn't leave it covered. I wanted to cool down as much as possible. So it created this dense film. So this side was not getting that quadrillage that I wanted, those grill marks here. So I flip it back over to its soft side. Awesome. And you can see I'm starting to form right here. Okay, those pretty lines that are going to create a beautiful marking here. So that's going to be my presentation side. That's the side I'm going to put up. And once we have those marks, then I can cut it into the triangles, stack it in the plate, and add the ratatouille, which we'll do here. And I think we have about one more minute, and then I'll be able to show that to you.
Perfect. So in that 1 minute, quick question for you. What kind of garlic was used? Was it diced, minced, or fresh?
Great question. Finely minced or diced, finely diced, right? It shouldn't be, there's a cut that's called a Brunoise cut, and that is 1/8 inch by 1/8 inch. Okay, so let me see if I can find one of the leftovers in the bowl. So this spot right here on the board, that is the size of the garlic we want to get to. So I cut it into slivers, and then I took my knife, put my fingers safely on the back, and then went back and forth until it was finely diced. There's nothing more upsetting, even for those of us that love garlic, there's nothing more upsetting than getting a huge piece of undercooked garlic in your bite. It kind of overpowers the dish and you can't taste anything else. Great question.
Couple other questions here. Should we let the polenta chill before grilling it?
That is your choice. So there's two ways to do it. So you can cook your polenta and you can have it be a soft, kind of thick mashed potato mass, or you can chill it in the fridge overnight like I did. But when you serve the final dish, everything should be warm.
All right, perfect.
All right, let's check on these real quick and see how we're coming along. All right, for the sake of time, we're gonna go ahead and move forward here. I know these aren't standing out very, very vibrant, but we can see some of those marks starting to come in. We have more time. I would give it another 3 minutes here so that we could see a more pronounced color of the quadrillage. But unfortunately, we cannot. I do apologize for that. But you can see where I'm going with this, right? You can see those marks starting to happen here, those little grill marks, which is going to stand out as a contrast of color in your final dish, which is what we want. Okay. So you'll turn it up, you'll oil your grill, make sure that you get that mark. Should have some set of lines for your mark here. Okay, next step is I'm going to make my dish. Okay, so I talked about triangles. Very appealing to the eye to have triangles, points, and height in your dish. Okay, triangles allow you to do that by stacking on top of itself. So I've chosen to use a bowl here to help hold the ratatouille in this bowl. Okay, so you can see that I have a point. I have some height for the ratatouille to come in. Fun fact, when you are doing dishes, the eyes are drawn to odd numbers. Okay, so we like seeing odds on our plates. So I have two here. I'm going to go ahead and add a third. Okay, and get some height. Okay, so at this point we have a 1, 2, 3. We have a little bit of height to it, and now I can add the ratatouille and the sauce to it. So let's check on the ratatouille, which again should be completely baked for your 30 minutes here. Luckily, I'd already made some this morning for us to use. Okay. Woo, beautiful. All right, so this is ratatouille, okay? So it's been sitting in the oven for 30 minutes. You can see how that tomato's kind of created a sauce. Everything is melded together here. And this is what we want. We don't want it to be super soupy. We don't want it to be very thick. We want a little bit of runny, but the majority of it to hold and come together, okay? You can see that it's steaming and getting all of the extra liquid off. That's why I want to keep that lid on top so that it doesn't escape. Otherwise, this would be very dry and crusty here. Okay, so I have my plate laid out. I want to make sure that everything is nice and centered here, has good height to it. And now I'm going to scoop some of the ratatouille on top. Remember, this just came out of the oven, very hot. So be careful. All right. Beautiful. And here I'm layering my plate, right? Remember, the polenta is a complement here. Okay, the ratatouille is the star of the show. So I wanna make sure that we get enough ratatouille. That's our sauce, okay? The polenta will be very dry if we don't have enough of these vegetables on it. So make sure that we get a nice even spread of the vegetables here. Okay. And then last thing we're going to do is garnish. This has, anytime you garnish, you wanna use stuff that's already in the dish. You want to complement those flavors. You don't wanna take away from those flavors by adding a garnish that has a completely different flavor, unless you're looking for a contrast here. What I want to do is complement it. So I'm going to take a little bit of shaved Parmesan and sprinkle it over the top because I have Parmesan mixed in with the polenta. And in about 2 minutes, that's going to start melting on here, creating a cheesy goodness. And then lastly, remember that flat leaf parsley that we added into the ratatouille? I'm going to sprinkle that for a little bit of green. So right now we have yellow, red, and white, which is okay, but it doesn't stand out. It's not super appealing to the eye. So I do want a pop of color, a little bit more green in here to fill that white space and to make that red and yellow stand out. Okay. And so at the end, you can see from this angle, you can see the height on the dish, right? It's standing up. It looks pretty. It's coming at me. It's ready to be eaten, right? But from the top, you can see that I have this well-balanced dish, very good balance of colors. I have white, I have green, I have yellow, I have red, and red and green contrast each other here. Until we get to this finished product, I have a nice clean bowl around the side that swoops into itself. So all of that flavor is going to come together. Okay, this is vegetarian. This is also a relatively cheap dish, which is great. It's filling, it's healthy, it's tasty, and you can reheat it pretty well. So I apologize for not being able to get the most beautiful grill marks on here, but that would just take a little bit more time, which we don't have today. So hope that helped. I think that's all I have for this beautiful, again, Parmesan polenta with a rustic ratatouille. So any questions?
All right. So Chef, there's a few questions that we have here. So I'll start from the last ones and kind of trickle my way backward. Question here from Arthita from Tampa. She's asking, can you add some Parmesan to the polenta while cooking and then after while plating?
Yes. You saw me add the Parmesan at the end there. There was Parmesan in the polenta, that recipe that kind of came with coming to this demo. So after you've made your polenta until it's soft and starting to come together after that 5 minutes, the last thing you're going to do is take about half a cup of this shaved Parmesan and whisk it in until it melts. So now we have a Parmesan polenta that tastes amazing by itself that only tastes better when you've added the ratatouille on top. Great question.
Very good. And then another question on tasting while cooking. I know you've made this this dish time and time and time again. So you're very familiar with the flavor. But regularly, when a person is making something, when tasting and as they're going along, how often should they be doing that?
Great question. Depends on the cooking process here. So I don't want to taste the par-cooked vegetables. I don't want to taste the onion, zucchini, eggplant while I'm sauteing them. Once we get to this point where it comes out of the oven, that is where I want to taste it, see if it needs a little bit more salt and pepper, see if it needs some hot sauce, see if it needs some vinegar in there. You always want to taste your final product before you plate it, right? I was able to taste the polenta along the way while I was cooking it yesterday. So once it was nice and soft and the cheese was on, I could taste it, make sure it wasn't too salty. And then you were correct. So when it comes out of the oven, you do want to taste it before you put it on the plate. Because if this tastes very foul, I don't want to serve that to anybody. Great question.
Right?
I think it tastes good. It smells really good.
There we go. Perfect. Let's see another question here. Polenta looks pretty fine. How early or in advance should we prepare the vegetables for ratatouille?
Ratatouille is going to be instant. Okay, so the polenta you can prepare the night before. Par-cooked zucchini, eggplant, onions, and peppers, if you were to cook those the night before and then put them in the fridge, they would dehydrate, they would wilt, and get very soggy. They would turn gray and brown, right? So that's why I did the eggplant last, because it turns almost like potatoes out of water. It starts to oxidize. So you want to cook them. These vegetables that I had that I added to the eggplant, I cooked 5 minutes before we started this process. Great question.
Perfect. And then guys, these questions I'm actually just getting from the chat area. I know that a few of you guys posted on the Q&A section, so I'm going to get to those here in 2 seconds. A couple last questions though from the chat area. Did you use a pan oil, like a spray oil or cooking oil for the actual pan for the polenta? And also, what other vegetables other than the garlic did you also cook with?
Great questions. So for the pan that the polenta came in, right, I cooked it in a little pot, right, like you would cook instant mashed potatoes or grits, and then I poured it into that cast iron pan. Before I put it in there, I did put some olive oil on a paper towel and brush it down. I tend to stay away from the spray oils. They have a slightly metallic taste to them that I don't enjoy. So I wanted the pure olive oil straight on there to keep it from sticking. And then when I did it in this cast iron over here, I also had already brushed that with olive oil and a little bit of paper towel. Great question. And then for the vegetables you use, your vegetables for ratatouille in order are going to be your onions, green or red bell pepper, zucchini, and eggplant. Okay, those are what you're going to cut up and saute. Your last vegetable, you're going to add a little bit of garlic when you're sauteing the onions towards the end. And then your last vegetable, but botanically is a fruit, but is a vegetable in the kitchen, is going to be your tomato. So I added the crushed tomato in at the end to help create that sauce.
Perfect.
Great question.
Couple polenta questions. Can you find polenta at any grocery store? Or does it have to be like a specialty type store?
That is a challenging question I can't answer and will require a little bit of research on your end. If you're in a bigger town or city, if you're near a capital, you should be able to find it at your Whole Foods, your Kroger, your Publix, your King Supers, Albertsons, but you'll have to look ahead of time. If you're in a smaller town, under 500 people, you may not be able to find it, but you may be able to find grits, which is very similar. You could use some coarse grits in place of the polenta. Can't use the cornmeal because it's too fine, but you could use grits. The other option, I know it's very capitalistic, but Amazon has everything. So if you look on Amazon, you'll be able to find it.
Right. And that was another question Enrique asked here a second ago, what polenta brand would be a good one or substitute to use?
Brands I don't know off the top of my head. I use Bob's Red Mill a decent amount for any flour or grain products. They have just about everything you could need for that. I'm not saying that they're the best. I'm not saying that they're the worst. I just know that they have a wide variety of grains and flours here.
Perfect. And also he noticed, it looks like Lane, noticed that you're using a ribbed iron skillet. Is that preferable to a flat frying pan or what's the preference?
Great question. So a couple things here. With grilling, the best thing you can do is grill outside. I don't have access to an outside grill there. So this is an indoor grill with those raised ridges so I can get the grill marks on it if I let it cook a little bit longer. That is preferred. You can do it in a flat saute pan like we have the ratatouille in. Polenta, it's especially once I've added the cheese to it, even letting it set overnight gets very, very sticky. So, I'll give you an example here. So, this cast iron pan, you can see everything that was left on it, right? So, what I'm getting to is surface area, a little bit of science here. If I have less surface area touching the polenta, it's less likely to be a problem and fall apart and stick. If you put it on a flat surface, even with like copious amounts of oil, especially with that melted cheese in there, it will very, very likely stick. So I lean towards grilled. You can definitely do it in a saute pan, but it will require a little bit more finesse. Great question.
Perfect. And Evan is asking, is there a way to cook this dish limiting the amount of oil used? Spray oils might have a metallic taste, but are there any other methods to limit oil amounts and also make it a lower fat dish?
Yes, great question. Let me think through it. So omit the cheese from the polenta, right? That's going to be your fatty slice. You're going to get more from that than you will the oil you saute with. Use less oil when you're sauteing. You could do a dry saute of your onions and your zucchini and your eggplant, but they're going to stick to the bottom of the pan here. So you could definitely use less oil when sauteing there. There's no oil added into the tomato. We just need it as a lubricant to keep things from sticking to the pan. So use as little as you can there, and then omit the parmesan, which is going to be your heaviest fat content here. Great question.
Perfect. And a couple more questions on the Q&A section. Gina's asking, is this an original dish from you?
Yes and no. So great question. This is my recipe. This is my take on it. The one that was included with this, I have written for the Parmesan polenta and the ratatouille. That being said, 500,000 people have made ratatouille before. Okay. Odds are that I'm either really close or I made it exactly the same as they did. I did not copy a recipe, but I'm making ratatouille, so which is guaranteed traditionally to have eggplant, zucchini, onion, and bell peppers, right? Throughout the history of time, everybody has probably made everything in the world. Okay, so if you think you're the first one to come up with something, not to burst your bubble, someone else has probably made something really similar to that. So, long story long, ratatouille is a common dish, made a French dish made throughout French times for hundreds of years, right? So someone has probably made it close to the same way here. But I did write this recipe, test it out, and measure out the ingredients and proportions to give to you guys. To you all.
Perfect. And then also, do we happen to have the nutrition macros for this particular dish that you made?
Unfortunately, not. That will change based on what you're using. So you can reverse engineer it and do a lot of math, right? If there are 400 calories and 2 grams of protein in this amount of Parmesan, and you're going to use 1/10 of it, you could do the math to figure out how much protein, how many carbohydrates, how many sugars, how many calories are in that, but I don't have that information for you.
Gotcha. And then Christina, she's asking, can you add meat, or would somebody want to
Yes.
add meat to this?
Yes. I love it with a little bit of meat. So, two ways to do this that I would recommend. Fish is probably a no-go on this one. Chicken would do great. So, if you were to crock pot or braise some chicken and then do a little bit of shredded chicken over the top, that would look lovely and pair really well. Chicken's pretty neutral here. The one that I tend to lean towards when I make this with meat is I will saute andouille sausage, which has
Ooh.
a crumbly version, which has a little bit of it's very earthy. It has a little bit of spice here. And it pairs really well with your tomatoes and the earthiness of your vegetables. It's separate, but it accents all the flavors, right? I don't want to throw in a wild card of salmon, right? That would be fishy. That doesn't pair with the dish. Andouille sausage has that fennel in it that really brings the whole thing together. So some crumbled andouille sausage, I would cook separately, crumble it up, and then I would mix it in with the ratatouille after it came out of the oven there. So you have this meaty andouille marinara vegetable dish with some cheesy polenta, a very well-balanced dish. Great question.
Perfect. All right, guys, great questions, by the way. I've been trying to field both from the chat side and also in the Q&A section. I see there's three more in the Q&A section. So, Chef, I
Yeah.
appreciate your time today.
Marco, I saw one real quick. Let me jump over here.
Yeah, go
And
for
you
it.
might have answered it already, Chef Dan, but is that olive oil or extra virgin olive oil that you used?
This happens to be extra virgin olive oil.
Okay.
olive oil works better. And also extra virgin olive oil should be used for dressings, right? But it is what I had, so that's what I wanted. They will work, but lean towards olive oil. It's going to have a slightly higher smoke point here, so you're going to get less smokiness like you saw when I was grilling. Great question.
Thank you. Marco?
Yeah, and a couple other questions here. I believe this was answered already. Can you prepare grits like polenta? I believe you said yes on that one.
Yes.
And then this guy's a fan of the movie. Where is Remy to assist you with your cooking of this dish today is gotcha. The question.
Unfortunately, I don't have any hair to like pull on and puppeteer me. So he's in my back pocket. We have this Morse code thing going on where he taps and lets me know what to do. But great question.
All right, guys, any other questions for Chef Bears today? These have all been really great questions, by the way. I want to thank everybody for asking and participating, making this super interactive. You know what? There was one question. So at the school, can a student learn how to, you mentioned calculate where the nutrition factors come into it. Can a person attending school learn how to do that?
Yes. I don't have the entire courses in all the school memorized. I cannot guarantee that. But what I can say is that we have hundreds of chef instructors who have worked, right? I've done cruise ship hotel, butchery, breakfast, and spent my time there. We have chefs who have done fine dining, started their own business, run food trucks. We have so many resources. The food industry is broad, right? There are so many different avenues you can go. They've done catering to running football arenas, right? And so there are all these resources that you can connect with these chef instructors. And we are all in touch with each other and able to refer towards other people. So again, I don't have all the courses memorized. I can't pinpoint a specific course. It may be in there, it may not be, but I can promise that we have instructors along the way who are willing to work with, spend time with you, and help answer the questions as best as they can. I know that wasn't a very complete answer, but that's unfortunately a little bit beyond my knowledge there.
Oh, no, we're good. And then Andres, he asked, how would you counterbalance putting too much salt in the polenta or ratatouille?
Great question. There is no solution if you've added too much salt. There are a couple things you can do, but number one, always add salt little by little by little and taste it before you move on there, right? Little, always, always, always. If you do not do that, that's how you get something that's oversalted. If something is oversalted, the only way to make it go away is to increase the amount of food you're making. So say you wanted to make one cup of polenta, but it was too salty. The only way to dilute that salt, make it less prominent, is to now make 4, 5, 6 cups of polenta and mix it together. Same thing with the ratatouille. If this was too salty and unservable, your next step would be to double it, triple it, and then mix it together with an unsalted version to help balance that.
Got it. All right, great, Chef. Thank you. And then how do you reheat this without it drying out?
Great question. I've reheated it in the microwave. The other way is to reheat it in the oven. Either way, both situations, you want to keep it covered. Or refrigerators or dehydrators, right? When you chill something, it takes the moisture out of it. Okay. Think of something you've left in there, your vegetables in the vegetable drawer that don't get touched, right? After time, they shrink and they lose all of their moisture. Okay. So I would eat it within 2-3 days max. And then when you go to microwave it, put a tablespoon of water in there and mix it together before you microwave it or put it in the oven and then make sure that it's covered in either situation. Great question.
Perfect. And guys, this will be the last question before we move into our presentation. This is from Lane. Do you recommend adding any sugar to reduce acidity or will this make it too sweet?
I don't. A little bit. I do teach, I've taught all the courses. One of the courses we go over is world cuisine, where we make traditional food. What I'm getting to is a lot of our food that we know and eat has been Americanized. Point in case being marinara spaghetti sauce has sugar in it. That's not true. That is an American thing, right? So in Italy, they don't add sweetness to it. The tomatoes and the cooked onions are already naturally sweet there when you take the water away. Same with your bell peppers, even a little bit. So I would not add any sugar to combat the acidity. It is naturally a very acidic dish. but the fattiness and cheesiness that you get from the polenta here will help combat that. So fat is going to help combat that acidity more so than sugar will. Great question.
Perfect. All right. Well, Chef Dan, thank you so much for your time today and also your demonstration. I believe there's probably going to be several of us that are going to be trying this tonight for dinner. So guys, thank you so much. Well, thank you, Chef Dan. And guys,